have everyone gathered with us today, and to those of you who are watching online, we are glad that you are there. Bev and the cross is beautiful. Thank you for helping to get us folks. Joe is leading in worship. Bev is leading the music. George is on camera. Tom and Don are taking care of the ushering duties. I do have a couple of announcements that I would like to share as we enter into this time of worship and prayer. For those of you who are not, haven't had a chance to look at your email today, Wanda Jones died yesterday afternoon, surrounded by her family. And she was at peace, and they were keeping her comfortable. So I will keep you in the loop for whatever comes next with that. Good news is that Margaret Zeke is doing well, so well in rehab, that she is moving. But she is moving to Cincinnati to be with her daughter, Clara. And so as soon as I have that address, I will share that with you as well. However, she often watches us, if not during worship, later on in the week. So, Margaret, we love you and we will miss you. And now I turn it over to you.
Some announcements this morning. As we continue to use alternative space for worship and office, please call either Pastor Nancy's cell phone or the church phone and use our regular mailing address at 121 East 7th Street. This week, Pastor Nancy will hold office hours on Monday from 10 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. and on Wednesday from 9 to 11:30 a.m. For those who would like to discuss the Breakthrough Prayer Initiative, please join us Tuesday evening at 7 p.m. for a Zoom discussion. Please watch a YouTube video, which there's a link provided, as we learn about Breakthrough Prayer, and a Zoom link for the Breakthrough Prayer discussion. Breakthrough Prayer discussion is included. Those will be included in the announcements email throughout the week as well. We need Crossbeams articles by this Wednesday. Please submit them to Michigan City Methodist Office, all one word, at gmail.com. We will commemorate All Saints Day on Sunday, November 3rd, so this Sunday after today. If you would like to have the name of a loved one who has died since last year's celebration, please send an email to Pastor Nancy by Tuesday, October 26th. So it looks like we're a little behind that. Is it too late to squeeze it in, Pastor?
It should be Tuesday, October. Whatever that date is.
Oh, okay, we're perfect. All right, that'd be the 29th. Oh, 29th, okay, never mind.
I was doing these very quickly this morning because they didn't save right on the publisher, so.
So you're safe, friends, until Tuesday, October 29th. Please use that same Michigan City Methodist office at gmail.com address. Join us for Messy Church this Friday, November 1st, from 6 to 7:30 p.m. We will meet at St. Paul's Lutheran Church as we focus on blessings. Remember, Messy Church is for all ages, and we will serve light snacks. Please also recall to continue making your donations of either cash or clothing items for the warming trees, particularly if you are interested in making monetary donations. I know that several of the folks running that have the ability to buy warm clothing at bulk prices, I think. So, but we won't turn down donations of socks or gloves or hats either. So, either way, and I think that concludes our announcement package.
Have you ever walked through your neighborhood with someone who's never been there before? If not, try it sometime. Because it's amazing what a new person will notice about the place where you live. Things you don't pay attention to anymore. When I'm walking down the street, I know where the street dips and goes down to the sewer. But I had a friend who tripped because she didn't know it and she didn't see it. Perhaps that's a bit how the crowd felt when Jesus stopped and responded to Bartimaeus in today's text, because Bartimaeus had been sitting
Had the crowds gotten so used to Bartimaeus' shouting that they neglected to actually pay attention to what he was saying? How many times had he called out for mercy, only to have his neighbors treat him as one more ignorable fixture in their lives? Now, maybe that's not fair, or not entirely fair. Sometimes we choose not to pay attention because we feel helpless to do anything. Noticing would require us to do something. But whether we are more like the crowd or more like Bartimaeus, or perhaps a mixture of the two, what are we struggling to see and hear and do something about as we come to worship? How can we break down the walls of our own expectations as we begin to see with the vision of Jesus? Please join me in our prayerful songs. Jesus is in our midst. Jesus, our healer, deliverer, and friend, is here.
We have heard so many good things about him,
but we long to meet him, to encounter him for ourselves.
Call out to him, and do not be silent. Like Bartimaeus, shout to him, and do not allow anyone to silence your voice. Cry out and tell Jesus what you need.
Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on us. We need a touch from you.
Touch us
in our need, which we live right now in our hearts.
In this time of worship, celebrate God's goodness. In this time of celebration of worship, know that Jesus has touched your place of need.
Hallelujah.
Amen. And our opening hymn this morning is Open My Eyes That I May See. If you happen to have your pocket handles, it's 454. If not, we've got that there for you.
Thank you.
comes to us from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. They came to Jericho. As he and his disciples and a large crowd were leaving Jericho, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
We have reached the end of the 10th chapter of the Gospel of Mark. We have looked at generosity. We have looked at, we're looking today at vision. Looked at different ways of walking with Jesus. Will you pray with me? Dear God, open our eyes, open our mouths, open our hearts, open our minds to the power and the doing of your word. Amen. This section of the 10th chapter of the Gospel of Mark ends a passage or a section that began in the 8th chapter with a story in which Jesus struggles to restore sight to the blind man at Bethsaida. And then in chapters 9 and 10, Jesus moves on, and he begins to confront another kind of blindness, a spiritual blindness among his closest followers who have a hard time understanding where Jesus is asking them to go. Part of what Jesus is doing in this section is he's preparing them. He's preparing them for the crucifixion, for the resurrection. He's preparing them to witness the harvest that is coming. I like to be prepared, but I'm not always well. Do you all remember, those of you who took it, and Joe probably took it most recently, the SAT or the ACT? He didn't even take the SAT, he took the ACT. Those are tests that you have to take to get into college. And back in the day, when most of us who went to college had to take those tests, they really didn't have a lot of prep classes. So you went in to the test blind, at least I did. And I did well on English. I did abysmally on math. Had to take it again. Because there was no preparation. There was no way to even know what it was this test was going to look like. Jump many decades later, and I had to take the grad record exam, and life had changed. I bought a DVD that I could play or a CD-ROM that I could play on my computer, and I could practice. And I practiced, and I practiced, and I practiced, and I prepared, and I took the GRE, and I prepared for a test I wasn't going to take, and had not prepared for the test that I was going to take. Again, I did fine on the English. This time I did a little bit better on the math. Have you ever felt like you have been prepared for something that isn't? Jesus was trying to prepare the disciples for something they had never experienced before. For something that none of us had really experienced before. We've seen the people that we love die. Some of us have even experienced having a loved one die violently. But most of us have not experienced being present with someone at their deathbed, walking with them through the hospice process, and then having them come back to new life. Jesus was preparing the disciples to open their eyes to see more clearly what it would be like to be people of faith in a post-resurrection world. How are they going to live and walk and be faithful people without his physical presence, but with his spiritual presence? Wouldn't you all like to have spent some time hearing him talk about? Wouldn't it be easier, perhaps, to walk the way of faith with Jesus right in front of us? Well, he's right there. We just can't see him anymore. But if we could, I think maybe we could learn something from this text. Jesus didn't just look at Bartimaeus or Bartimaeus, we really don't know how it was pronounced, son of Timothy. Jesus really didn't just look at him and oversee him. And he didn't look at him and assume that he, Jesus, knew what Bartimaeus needed. He didn't assume that in his power and privilege as the Son of God, he knew exactly what was needed. So he asked. He asked. How many of us see people in pain, see people in struggle, see people who disappoint us, see people that we tend to overlook? And not only say, hi, how are you doing today? But what do you need? Sometimes it's because we don't have the time that it will take to get the full answer. Or we choose not to take the time it will take to get the full answer. And sometimes it's because we feel helpless with the answer. We look at someone who is unhoused and we assume, well, what they need is a place to live. And I don't have the capacity to do that, so I'm not even going to talk to them. Sometimes, if we would say, how are you today? What do you need today? They might say, I need a toothbrush. Most of us could probably come up with a toothbrush. They might say, I just need to tell you it's a beautiful day. Sometimes we make assumptions. And Jesus showed us to not get so caught up in our own answers that we don't ask the questions. Because Bartimaeus said what he needed, Jesus was able to heal. We can't fix it all, but when we are stewards of our vision, we do a couple of things. We listen, we ask, we respond. That's what Jesus did. He saw, he heard, he asked, he responded. That's what this text is about. Jesus was preparing the disciples for life without his physical presence. See, listen, ask, respond. Now, we know through the texts that we have read where they argued over status, where they didn't really quite understand what it meant to follow him. We know they didn't always get it right. John Wesley told us, we may not be perfect in life, but let us be perfect in love. I think that's what Jesus was saying too. You may not get it, but be perfect in love. When we talk about healing, when we talk about stewardship as lives of generosity, lives of service, lives of vision, what we're really saying is, I give up the control of my life and trust the one who walks in front of me, beside me, and behind me. Prior to moving back to northern Indiana, I lived less than a mile from the Ohio River. And the church I served, literally, was on the banks of the river. Although, after the umpteenth flood, many of which went into the building and up into the second-story sanctuary and into the organ loft, and destroyed pipes. It was either 13 or 17 feet in the sanctuary on the second floor. Even in that church, I couldn't see the river anymore because they built a levee. But it was right on the banks of the Ohio. And I would go to the Ohio, and I would sit there, and I would watch that river flow. And sometimes it came all the way up on the bank, and then it would kind of go back. That was if a barge had gone on. And sometimes it was very quiet. Sometimes it was an amazing color. Y'all live on lake, you know the color of water. Sometimes it was gray. But the difference between the lake and the river is the river was never still. There was never that calm, reflective stillness that I see in lakes. There was a depth to that river, and it spread over all of us. there's a depth. Will you allow God's healing to touch you? Will you ask for what you need from those who can answer it? Will you follow Jesus through the cross to the resurrection because you have accepted the healing that is present? Will you reach out to others and listen to the depth of their stories so that they too may be healed? What is our vision? How are we stewards of that? And how are we stewards of the healing that comes when we are touched by the love of God? Will the choir please come to sing, O Healing River?
Thank you.
of you know, is back in the hospital with an additional infection, but he is doing well. So I would ask you to be in prayer for him. I think we can continue to pray for our building and for the workers who are there. I have not been in it in 2 weeks because they've been doing the asbestos abatement. But we keep seeing stuff being hauled out.
Can I just add a little something?
Yes.
So I drive by a lot because I'm really nosy. And just wanted to see if what activity was going on. And the workers happened to be on their break. So they were out on the front step. And a bunch of wonderful ladies and one gentleman, and they were real chatty. We stopped to say thank you and for what they were doing. And it turns out that they're from the town in Texas where my mom and dad retired.
Oh.
So it was really funny to say, oh, Mission, you're from Mission, Texas. And so they loved our church. They said it was just so beautiful, and it sounded like things were coming along really well. So, and there's a man who's washing windows.
Yeah. On the inside.
Inside, yeah. So it's coming along. One other little additional thing, we're going to try to get the warming trees dressed and ready to go because it's getting cold, and those coats and hats and things need to be out for the people who need them in our community. So that's going to happen probably on Tuesday. So if you do have things that you're collecting, let us know.
And I believe this year they're going to try to do the warming trees with men, women, and children. So if you drive by and you happen to have a lady's coat, look for the lady's tree.
We'll
be the feminine.
I do have one other announcement. The United Methodist Women Part of Women of Faith is having their annual cookie walk. It will be at St. Luke's Church on East Cold Spring, December 14th. We will have it in the bulletin, but we need lots of cookies. So if you're willing to bake, give us a call.
And if you're willing to buy, show up at St. Luke.
Is there an update on Jesse?
He was sick again. They had to go back, but I believe everybody's home. Everybody's doing well, and that's the latest update I've had. Because I was driving through Noblesville, I stopped and saw Scott and Felicia and did a blessing of their new home and got to see Moses the cat. For those of you who were keeping an eye out on the cat they rescued from the church bushes. And they are doing well. There have been some health struggles and some house struggles, but I believe Felicia is watching today, so it is good to have them there. And I believe that is all. So may we sing, Give Thanks.
Because he's given, Jesus Christ is Son.
Jesse is home, but still not feeling good, still needs prayers. He is definitely better. That came from Grandma Karen. Let's pray. Oh God, we give you thanks that you bring us healing, that you bring us physical healing, but that you also bring us spiritual healing. Guide us, lead us, walk with us as we try to follow in your footsteps, to walk with you as we offer your healing to the world. We pray for Wanda's family, for the sorrow they feel, for the peace they feel because she is at peace, for the joy and the laughter that comes when you remember. May these be special days for them. We pray for all who are still touched by our ministries, by those who will receive from the warming trees, by those who continue to receive from the soup kitchen. We give you thanks for this place and for St. Paul and for St. Luke, who have offered us space so that we can continue to be your church in Michigan City. We pray for our bishop, Tracy, for our district superintendent, Marty, for all of those who worship and lead. This we pray in the name of your Son, who teaches us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
offertory, I was catching up with the online community, and Grandma Karen also said that Jesse's house is beginning to look like a house because they've got drywall on. So for those of you who know the story, the Archers were burned out over a year ago, and they're finally getting back to their house looking like a house. So our prayer of healing for them is that they will no longer be living in a camper. Let's pray. Oh, gracious and holy God, give us vision, give us healing, and bless these offerings.
Our closing hymn this morning is Be Thou My Vision.
A loving hand to neighbors known and unknown. Amen.